paper was actually planned as a joint paper presented together with Lars, and unfortunately he couldn't come. And this paper draws on the master's thesis written by Lars Scharmann. And I must confess, I'm a bit out of my comfort zone because I do space syntax, and Lars was the one really kind of crazy about the fractals. So if there are any more technical questions, I'm afraid you have to write to Lars. So our starting point was how or even to what extent did the physical environment affect the past urban experience? And we are trying to come to terms with how an ancient city might have, how people living in an ancient city might have experienced the ancient city, and we have various ways of reconstructing this experience, but we try to do it through the physical environment. And doing this, we used fractal analysis and visibility graph analysis and urban theory from, it's called the urban information field. This is defined by Salingaros. And this is then how the geometry of the city, how it links with how we perceive it. I won't say much about the urban information field because this would be a paper on its own. And the data set we used to conduct this analysis is again a city block from Ostia. So by now you know Ostia quite well, and I'm sorry I take you there again. And we selected this particular city block since it has a bit of an informal growth, so it's not very regular, and in this way it makes it useful for fractal analysis, because if I would have an orthogonal city plan, this analysis would not get me anywhere. And you see here the block marked in red. It's in a very good location. It's at cross sections of several important roads, and it is focused on a temple dedicated to Hercules. So this is the block itself, and it has the on that side. It's this is the temple, and several buildings related to the temple. And in the western part, there are residential buildings. This is a bit what it looks like. You see the temple. There are mosaics. There are houses, and it's very mixed land use. There is even a bath building, so we have a bit of everything. And the chronology is from the Republican period, 3rd century BC, to the late 2nd century AD. So it's enjoyed an occupation for quite a substantial period of time. And from the construction dates, we see also that it is not built at one go by some master plan, but it's incremental growth, and the area developed over time and changed over time. And now to the fractals. And they have some properties. One is self-similarity, scale invariance, and they form power law relations. And the term fractal was coined by the mathematician Benoît Mandelbrot to describe objects that appear in a similar fashion at every scale at which they are observed. Fractals appear in nature. Our natural world is made out of meandering rivers, branching trees, and rugged coastlines. Trees and river branch out into smaller, approximately self-similar copies of themselves. Apart from fractals in nature, they are also helpful to gain a deeper understanding of the man-made world. For instance, fractals manifest in the morphology of cities or even in the social organization of societies. In mathematics, fractals are sets of data that are defined by their self-similarity, scale invariance, and the power law relations. I said this already. And in mathematics, a set is a collection of data. And the data can be point, lines, areas, multidimensional shapes, or time series. And an example of such a mathematical set is the so-called Sierpinski triangle. And this triangle is not just an ordinary triangle, but it consists of smaller versions of itself. And this is what this self-similarity is about. And if we scale in and out, so sort of then more triangles appear, because in essence it will always remain a triangle, regardless of the scale and the size, but it would always be triangles within triangles within triangles. So this is the fractal nature of it. And closely connected to the self-similarity is this scale invariance. And this occurs when a shape displays the same characteristics as every scale the shape is observed. And the last defining characteristic of fractal is the power law distribution, in which the relations between scale and the number of self-similarity pieces fall into. A power law is a distribution where the frequency of any phenomenon is inversely proportional to its rank. In the distribution of a fractal object, the rank is equal to the scale or the number of iterations. And this is kind of, if we plot this out then on a chart, we see this linear development which just remains the same. And this is then where we could see that we really are dealing with a fractal. And we have fractals also in urban contexts. Sort of these two diagrams visualize this a bit. The top one, if you imagine a transport system where every street would lead from an origin to a destination point, and so it would be quite ineffective and repetitive, because I would always have one street from origin to destination. And in a fractal transport system, the center would be shared, and then it branches out like in nature on a tree or something, and it goes from a larger to a smaller one, and it would have this at every scale. So this is in a way we can imagine this quite well working if you think of an underground system, because the center would use a shared tube, and then it branches out in different directions, and in this way it's quite effective. And the same would be also applied to cities. An example would be parks in a city, that we would have one big park, and then it goes down to smaller parks, up to small playgrounds for children at a smaller scale. So in this way, this urban features would also be distributed in a fractal relationship. And the same would apply to neighborhoods, where I have a neighborhood with a very diverse land use, and in a way the neighborhood then reflects the city as a whole. So again, the neighborhood would be a fractal relationship. And these are just a comparison between fractal cities and non-fractal cities, and you can see this is really just works at the opposite, in the opposite way, like where if I have not fractal properties, you would have wide streets which suppress the small scales, and this we can also relate this to the flow. So we would have just one speed of flow, not the like a car flow at a higher speed and then a pedestrian flow, but we would have just one high speed flow, and kind of we can play this in modern cities for many examples. And We see those elements, of course, also in the ancient cities. And how is this done, this fractal analysis? It's quite a simple box counting method on works two-dimensionally. This is an example from a transport system. It's the regional rail system of Albany in New York. And then you would have it plotted in, you see here, with big squares. Then in the next round of analysis, the squares are smaller and proportionally smaller and smaller. And then you count the boxes which are filled with the feature and not. And those numbers, then the number of occupied boxes and the box size are then plotted. And here, if you get the linear line, then again, you have this fractal dimension and this fractal relationship visible if it's really proportional and in scale and in size. Why is this all important? If we take a city, and in order to relate to the city, we need all scales. This is an example from floor mosaics from Portugal, where the pedestrian can connect to the small scale of the floor mosaics, and from the smaller scale he can scale up and connect to the bigger city, to the buildings and to the roads. And this helps the people to deal with an urban environment. You are not alienated by an environment which works at all scales. And kind of this, the idea of the fractals goes even deeper, because it relates to human evolution, where we think that our brain also developed in a fractal way, that we can make categories and we can decode and encode our environment. And by the fact that our brain works in a fractal way, this is also means that we construct our urban environment, our man-made environment, we would construct this in a fractal way. So this would be the cognitive connection then from our evolution to how we construct our man-made environment. So coming back to the case study, we did this for this small urban section of Austria, and Lars used the box counting method, and he calculated everything. We have our graph, and we came up with a fractal dimension of 1.451. And quite interestingly enough, this is the same fractal dimension which we can calculate for a savanna landscape. And the savanna landscape is the one where we know that in our human evolution we felt the most at ease with. So this is an environment where we are comfortable because of the scale and the fractal environment. And so kind of my urban environment really has a dimension has a fractal dimension of an extremely comfortable environment where people feel at ease and feel at home, and in a way then can relate to the larger scale of the city. And the fact that this block had a very long occupation and was active for a long time might even suggest and maybe confirm that people felt comfortable in this environment. We also did visibility graph analysis at the different second round of analysis. And the visibility graph analysis also identified as kind of some visual hubs where people might then gather and come together. And it would also contribute again to the urban experience and how give us clues about how space was used and where people flock and carry out their activities. With the urban information field, this would be then another layer of analysis. I don't want to go into this, but this is also plays on our cognitive abilities, how we perceive the environment and how we relate to it based on on geometry and based on the built environment. Another visibility graph analysis, we extended the research area a bit, and we could see the visual field clustering a bit further away from our research area. And in this way, we could see that the from outside, the area remains quite quite a level of privacy. And once you go inside, it is extremely well connected and gives people quite a safe environment where they can feel comfortable and carry out their everyday activities. I add also a list of literature, and our experiment remained quite experimental, because many cities won't warrant a fractional analysis because they would be too geometrically planned, and there might some areas of Pompeii where we could use it, and it has been used for modern cities quite a bit. For ancient cities, we are a bit of pioneers in this regard, but I think it is a different way of looking into a city, and it might also be, we might be able to connect it to other questions like possessions, or where would people really would like to spend most time in a city, in other than their commercial efficiency driven daily life, but kind of more concerned with an informal use of space, and how people kind of really would enjoy an ancient city and find, really identify spaces where we at a human level can feel at ease and enjoy the environment. So I would like to thank Lars also for doing the analysis, and thank you for your attention.